Hey guys, Josiah here at EasyCaters.com, and today I just wanted to do a quick programming tutorial for ThinkScript. For any of you guys that are interested in learning ThinkScript, I just thought I'd walk through doing a conversion from a PineScript indicator for TradingView. I had a customer that wanted to convert a TradingView indicator to Thinkorswim, and so I'm just going to walk through doing that and record it for you so that you can kind of see how the two languages work together, how they can be ported one from the other, and you know, what the differences are and what the similarities are. So to start out, I'm just going to create a blank indicator here from the Edit Studies window, and I'll call this, I have the indicator here. This is not my script. It's something from TradingView, like I said, and it evidently is an open source script, and it's a fairly simple code here, so I just wanted to show how that works in Thinkorswim, porting it over. So I'm just going to copy and paste this into Thinkorswim, and we'll call this VWAP rolling because I think it's a rolling period VWAP or a cumulative period VWAP. So first of all, in PineScript, comments are done with a double slash. In Thinkorswim, that's done with a pound symbol. So to get that to start cleaning up here, we can replace any of these double slashes with just a pound symbol. And we don't really need all this, these comments, but I'll leave them here just for instructive purposes. And so you can see we've cleared up the errors on that section of code as well. And so now we've just got the main indicator code down here at the bottom. And actually, it looks like I commented out part of the text here that I actually need. Let's see here. The autocorrect is giving me some trouble, so let me fix that. I'm going to go ahead and add a def statement here, so maybe it won't keep deleting. Okay, it looks like that stopped it. Okay, so in PineScript for TradingView, you don't have to use the keyword define or def. You can just type a variable name and say what it is equal to, you know. But in ThinkScript, you do need to use the keyword def to create your variables. So def VWAP equals cumulative typical price times volume divided by cumulative volume. And I see what they're doing here. This is actually just an instruction on what it is. And then the code to actually do it is down here. So first of all, we've got an input here. Cumulative period equals input 14, and the title of it is period. So to convert that to ThinkScript, we'll say input cumulative period equals 14. And by capitalizing the second word here, that automatically in the inputs, that will create another word at that there, and it'll add a space in the text, so that gives it a title already. So it's nice to name your variable or your input variables here, things that make sense, and it's nice to capitalize them at the beginnings of words so they automatically create, you know, readable text in the input fields. Okay, then we got typical price equals high plus low plus close divided by 3. So typical price, VWAP looks for the typical price of a bar, the average price of a bar inside the bar. And there's lots of different ways of doing this. High, low, close divided by 3, high, low, 2, open, high, low, close divided by 4, so forth. So we'll do def typical price equals high, low, close 3. And so that would be a direct conversion. But Thinkorswim actually has a special price point called VWAP itself. And this is the VWAP of each individual bar, the volume weighted average price of the bar. So it's not just adding together all the prices from the bar and dividing by three or whatever. It's actually looking at the volume weighted average price during that bar. And so we can directly reference that. And this, and in doing this, actually, if we switch this to an input, this will allow the user to switch between choosing VWAP, the price point VWAP, or high, low, close 3, or high, low 2, or open, high, low, close 4. They'll be able to actually choose between any of those themselves. So that's how I would do that. Next, we have typical price. Let me just comment out the rest of these lines. And then we can go through and convert them to ThinkScript individually here. Typical price volume equals typical price times volume. So I'll just double click this variable here and copy it so I don't have to type it out manually. And then I'll say typical price. So we're referencing this input variable or constant here. Typical price times volume. So whatever price they choose up here in the input, it's going to multiply it by volume, and that's going to be stored in this typical price volume variable. But I don't really like including these price points in the code, hard coding them in is what I would consider. So I want to let the user choose what kind of volume. Typical, let's just call it volume source equals volume. And what this does is it allows us to specify this one time and use it anywhere else in the code using this variable, but it also allows the user to select if they want to use volume or tick count instead of volume. And so they can make a volume weighted or a tick count weighted average price or the normal volume weighted average price. So they get to choose which volume source they want to use there. All right, next line. We've got cumulative typical price volume. So they're accumulating the typical price times volume calculation. So in order not to have to type this out, I'm again going to copy and paste that down here. Equals sum typical price volume over cumulative period. And cumulative period is up here in the inputs, so that's 14 by default. Then we got the next line. Cumulative volume by itself, paste that in there, and we can actually just directly copy and paste this same code, I believe. I don't think there should be any differences here. You just need to make sure you end the lines with a semicolon. The only difference here is we do need to use that volume source keyword instead of hard coding volume in there. So it's going to sum the volume source across 14 periods and store it in this variable here. Now VWAP value, def VWAP value, equals the cumulative typical price times volume divided by the cumulative volume. And so then this is the PineScript plot statement, but in Thinkorswim, we need plot and we need a name for the plot. So, and it can't be the same as this variable up here. Though what we could do instead, just as opposed to complicating things, we could lump them both together and use a plot statement for both instead of a def statement and then a plot statement with a separate name. So this way we can keep the same name just go ahead and directly output it to the screen. Now, one other thing I wanted to add here is declare upper. That makes sure that it, by default it's in the upper price graph area. We've already got the name of the script up here, so I'm going to click OK. And so we've got it added up here automatically on the price graph. And so this is what that looks like. If we right-click, we can go in here and edit the settings. And so you can see you can change the cumulative period. We can change it to a 50 period. So that's a 50 period rolling VWAP. We can change the VWAP price point to open high low close 4 or high low close 3 or high low 2, whichever the person prefers. And we can change volume. We can change that to open interest or tick count or implied volatility or whatever else we want to do. We can weight it by any of these inputs or these price points or volume points. We can change the color here. We can change the line style. And we can change the line thickness and so forth. We can hide the plot by doing that. We can hide just the bubble on the sidebar here by unchecking that. We can hide the title. The title shows up here in the data box. Can't really see it because it's actually off the side of the screen. But you can show or hide that using this checkbox here. And then once we get this set how we want it, we can click Save as Default, and that will apply those changes. So anytime we add this indicator to a chart in the future, it will automatically be set with these color preferences and everything, the length setting and all that. you can use these checkboxes here to show the plot names in the data box, the input names in the data box, and you can also set it to the left axis over here instead of the right axis if you prefer that. One other thing we could add to this, real quickly, just for interest's sake, is we could add alerts. And so let's put an input and say, use alerts, yes or no. Actually, I'll default it to no. And so this is a Boolean input, yes or no being one or zero or true, false, essentially. And so down here, I'll just say alerts, settings, or we'll just say alerts. And now we'll add the alert keyword. And we can go in here and use the parameters inputs here to tell us how it wants to receive the settings. So it says the condition for at which the alert would be triggered. So let's program a alert trigger. And we'll just say price crossing the VWAP value. Let's say input alert price equals close. We want to look at the close crossing the VWAP. And so down here we'll say def alert condition equals close. And actually we'll call this up signal. Close crosses above VWAP value, and def down signal equal close crosses below VWAP value. And I realized that I used close here instead of alert price. And so if we use alert price here instead, it'll allow the user to change that price whenever they want. And let's see, now in here in alert, we need to say the condition. So we can say up signal. If up signal is true, that means the alert price has crossed above VWAP value. So that would say that there is a signal happening. If that's true, then we're going to say price crossed above VWAP. And so that message will show up in the message center. And then we're going to say alert.bar. That's going to say on each bar instead of just one and done or so forth. And then sound.ding. I prefer the ding just because it's less obtrusive. And so I just set all my defaults to the ding sound. And then this one is going to be down signal, price crossed below VWAP. And the same settings for those things. Now, there's only one thing that we need to change here, and that is that, well, we set up use alert, yes or no, but we didn't actually connect it in any way to tell this to turn the alerts on or off. So we need to connect that up somehow. So the way that we do that is say if use alert is true and there is an up signal, then we're going to have an up signal alert. If use alert is true and there's a down signal, we're going to have a down signal alert. So I don't like using if these two things are true, then yes, else no. I would prefer just the simple logic of up signal and use alert, or use alert and up signal. Use alert and down signal. And so basically, if both of these variables resolve to true, to yes, then we'll have a signal or an alert happen. So we don't need to include, I mean, alternative way of doing this would be if use alert and up signal, then yes, else no. Or you could do it as one, else zero. And that would all resolve to the same exact thing. It's just my way is a lot cleaner. That's not really my way. It's just a simpler way of writing it all. So if both of these resolve to true, so if this is yes, and also there's an up signal, then it will have this alert. If this is yes, and there's a down signal, then it'll have this alert. If this is no at any point, then it's going to not get even, it's going to start reading this and say, you know, we're not going to do anything here because we already know that this says no, so we don't even need to evaluate if there's an up signal or a down signal. And so it'll just stop execution right there. So that's how that works. And so now we can click OK to apply. And we can go in here and see our work. And so now we have this alert subpanel that's appeared. And you can see alert 1 and 2, price cross below VWAP for number 2, above VWAP for number 1. You can enable or disable them here with this checkbox for each one individually, or you can disable both of them by setting them to no here. You can enable them by setting it to yes, and you can change this to, you know, the high-low 2 crossing the VWAP, or the VWAP crossing the VWAP, or whatever you want. And then down here you can change the default ding sound, which I had specified, to the bell or the ring or whatever else you want. And you can even turn off the message center or whatever you want to do there. And when I said sound dot or alert dot bar, it automatically selected this repeatedly for each bar instead of repeatedly for each tick, or once and then done. So that was just providing some default settings to that alert so that it wouldn't be going off on every tick. I think that's all we probably need to do for this one, and we've probably done more than we need to do, really, but I like to provide a little extra value and for any scripts that I do, and I thought maybe adding the alert would be a good thing to show you guys how those work. So hopefully that helps, and I will leave the code in the comments. And if you guys have any questions, please feel free to leave a comment or send me an email on the website. Please hit like and subscribe if this has been helpful in any way. And I will talk to you next time.